Now let's take a look at the same calculation, except this time we're going to do it using visualstudio.net instead of VB6. So here's we're going to be creating essentially the same thing. I'm going to go ahead and open up a copy of visualstudio.net. And this is actually already started up. And what I'd like to do is go ahead and choose Tools, and within Tools choose PyAceWizard. I'm going to do a new ace calculation. And this dialog box appears. At this point, we can go ahead and specify the name of, well, what's being labeled the executable. In fact, in the case of visualstudio.net, this ends up being the class library, the DLL that gets created. So I'm going to call this my ace calcs. And as I said, unlike in VB6, that's actually going to be a DLL. It's going to be stored in the PyPC directory. And within this particular calculation, or excuse me, this particular class library, I'm going to be building one particular module that I would like to call first calc. Now that does not have to be the only module in there. I can create many different modules. And the decision as to how many modules you'd like to build or how many of these calculations you would build within a DLL is really entirely up to you. It's really just a matter of how you'd like to organize your work. So when I go ahead and choose Next, that will go ahead and bring up this dialog box where I can start specifying inputs and outputs. Now let me just show you briefly exactly what, let me show the desktop here, exactly where this information is going to be stored. If you look in the PyPC directory under ACE, you'll find a section called Class Libraries. So when I finally save this calculation, you'll notice that it will show up just like a these other DLLs. It's going to show up the project in Visual Basic and the DLL itself in the binary. So this is where we're storing all this. On this dialog box, we specify the inputs and the outputs to this calculation. Now the input can be a Py tag, which you can get using a tag search or just by typing in the name of a tag. For example, that's a temperature transmitter tag. You can also use aliases if you've got a module database structure set up. Now the module database, our initial asset database object, will allow you to specify the context essentially. So for example, if I say my context is this reactor 2401, go ahead and select that as my context. Then when I do an alias search, let me search for all aliases, we'll be able to find those things that have been organized under that particular reactor. So as I can actually have a calculation that is relative to what context we're looking at. Now that's going to be described a lot more later on, but just to let you know, you can specify both aliases and tag names. Let me get rid of that. I'll remove that. And so at this point, I've got the input that I'd like. And for this calculation, what I'd like to do is a simple conversion from centigrade to Fahrenheit. That's going to be my input. I need an output that's going to contain this, and that can be an existing tag, or it could actually be a tag that doesn't exist because there's an option right here to configure the tag on the fly. So for example, what I'd like to do is let's configure this as, we'll just call this BA temp.1, we'll call this underscore FH for Fahrenheit. And I think I'll change this and make this a 1 instead of a 0 there. One instead of a 2. Let's actually go all the way to 0. That compression deviation is set to 0. Is going to ensure that we store every single result. And I can put it into description, etc. I'll go ahead and create this and close. And this is going to be my output tag. So we're just about ready to start doing the calculation itself. One last thing I should mention is we do have input clamping and output clamping. So on input, I can do an underrange or overrange clamping, or both, which basically means that if there is a value that goes above the top of the range, we can clamp on the top of the range. We can also do some substitutions. If the inputs go bad, we can look for the previous value. We can just substitute the typical value as defined in the point database. We can choose the zero, the maximum, or you can just specify what the value is. So if I say 55.5, then if there's any error here, we'll just substitute that. But we'll go with no substitution. Those same options are available from or for the outputs. So you'll notice that those same kind of clamping options are available. Once you've got what you need, go ahead and choose Finish. And this is going to generate a bunch of code that we'll look at in our next segment. So here's the code that was generated by the wizard. There's a couple of important things to notice. First of all, well, there's a lot of code here, and a lot of it has been generated as boilerplate code by the wizard. So for example, if we go into these references or this assembly, what you'll see is there's a lot of boilerplate code. A lot of references have been made for us, a lot of code's been written. And these are things that you don't really have to pay attention to. We can treat them like a black box, because all we really have to deal with is the calculation section. And that calculation is implemented in this subroutine right here called ACE calculations. Now there are some other sections that we'll describe a little bit later on. The second thing to notice is that we've generated some Visual Basic variable names. Here's the variable name for my input tag. My input tag was called ba:temp.1. Or excuse me, that's my output tag. Here's my input tag, ba:temp.1. If you notice, we've substituted underscores for those characters, the colon and the period. And we did that because this is going to be a VB.NET variable, and those variables' names don't support that syntax, the period and the colon. So these are the tags, or the actual variables, that we can make use of in our calculation. So my calculation is going to be a conversion. So I would like to say that the value of this is going to be equal to the converted value of that right there. I can do that by simply starting to type the name of that output variable. It's called ba:temp_1_fh. And when I press the period key, as you can see, IntelliSense kicks in to show us what the different properties and methods are under that particular variable. And in this case, I'd like to specify the value. We're going to say the value is equal to our calculation. So let's go with 9/5 times the value in centigrade. The value in centigrade is this other variable right here, ba:temp1. We'll go with ba:temp_1.value. And to complete the conversion, we'll add 32. So that becomes our calculation. And as you can see, the calculation appears to be intact. We don't see any errors or squiggly lines or whatnot. If I were to remove the multiplication, as you can see, now VB.NET is generating an error, showing us that there is some error in here. And so let me go ahead and restore this. Once we restore that, this should show us that we've got a calculation that looks good so far. I'd like to debug at this point, although it's kind of a simplistic calculation. What I'd like to do is go ahead and choose the Tools menu, Pious Wizard, and then choose Debug. Now, I want to explain something that's a fairly common mistake that we'll see. We're going to debug this calculation. There we go. At this point, we're going to step line by line through this code, and we'll use IntelliSense to see the value of things. So, for example, I can see the current value of that. Well, it doesn't have a current value. Oh, there it is. Value is 38. And I'd like to see if this is going to generate any errors or if it's going to give me a good value here. However, with the debugging options that you'll see by default in .NET, when we get into objects like this value object, which is part of the ACE assembly, when we get to that, if you simply use the debug option called step into, it's going to try to load that code, the debugging code for that assembly. In fact, that we don't ship that. We don't ship source code with ACE, so we can't in fact debug that. So what we do instead is choose step over. What step over does is it will go ahead and continue to execute, but it won't be debugging and trying to bring up those assemblies so that we can, you know, show the source code for things that are actually part of the ACE executables. As I go through, let me go ahead and step over again. As I can see now, we do have a value that's been converted. This value right here, 38, has been converted to 101. So we can do our debugging. We just suggest that you choose step over when you're doing that. Otherwise, what you'll see is something that looks something like this. It's going to say there's no code available. Basically, that's because it's trying to debug part of the ACE executables. So I'm going to go ahead and stop this debugging. But that's how you would go through and debug this. You can step through this one line at a time and take a look at the logic and the variable values and do debugging that way. I'd like to test the calculation now. We can do that within the PyACE menu. So if you go into PyACE Wizard and choose Test, this is going to go ahead and compile and then allow you to test. And the simplest way to test would be to simply take the current value, choose Calculate Now, and see if the calculation looks correct. You can also do things like get the typical value, calculate based on the typical value, and we can even go into this section here and do a variety of kind of open-ended tests where you specify min, max, typical, and current value and see what kind of results you get based on those inputs. So in this case, this is telling us that many of these are going above the range of 100. This tag currently has a value that goes from 0 to 100, the range, and it looks like I'd better make that output tag have a larger range because some of the results are going beyond the top. You can also choose to test against bad values just in case you've got some logic to try to do substitution or something in the case of bad values. And when we're done, you'll be done when you're satisfied that what you've tested is showing you that under a variety of circumstances with typical values, current values, etc., you're getting a calculation that is accurate. Finally, after you're satisfied that the logic and the testing proves to you that that you've got a good, viable calculation, you can register that. Go into Tools, PyACE Wizard, and choose to register. Now, when we say register, what we mean by that is this is going to tell the Py server about this calculation. It's going to define the scheduling for the calculation and store that on the Py server, and basically get this into the queue so that it will continue to be executed by the Py manager. So if we take a look at the scheduling options, we can either specify a time-based calculation, in which case we can say, well, let's go with 0 seconds offset 60 seconds period. That means once every 60 seconds at exactly at the 0 second mark, we'll do this calculation. Or if I set it at the 5 second mark, it'll go at every 5 seconds after the minute. Just to give you another example, let's say we were going to go with a 7 hour offset and an 8 hour period. That would be a calculation that runs 3 times a day, one at 7, one at 3, and one at 11. And in this case, we're going to do something fairly simple. Now we can specify this as a 1 minute calculation. Excuse me. As a 1 minute calculation with 0 minute offsets, 0 seconds. So that means it'll go right at the 0 minute mark of the hour. Or we have the option to go into natural scheduling. Now by natural, what we mean is the calculation is going to be executed anytime the input that you specify gets a new snapshot value. So in this case, I specify natural scheduling as opposed to clock scheduling. That means every time a new snapshot value comes in, this calculation will be executed. Once I say OK, this has now been registered, and now the ACE manager is ready to go ahead and pick up this calculation and start calculating it based on the scheduling you've defined.